requires this little experiment where you put water on these sugar cubes and you heat them up. And what you'll find is that the water, just like we did in the metamorphic reactions lab, we saw that water enhances chemical or speeds up chemical reactions. So what you should find here is that the wet cube will melt first. And you can do this experiment at home. Basically, you're going to caramelize the sugar, but you'll find that when you put water on one, it'll melt. The wet one will melt before the dry one. And so that means that something facilitated, remember a flux is something that enables a reaction to occur. In this case, the water was the flux. It facilitated that reaction. When we're looking at, now we're going to be looking at this wet prototype solidus, and which represents volatiles, mostly water, carbon dioxide, right? And here the prototype mass is to the left of the wet solidus is 100%, right? And anything to the right would be partial melting. So this would happen in subduction zones as water is released by the hydrated slab at 100 kilometers depth. The volatiles induce hydrous flux melting in the prototype mantle wedge, which is right above there in the subduction zone. And what would be the minimum temperature this would occur? So let's look at a drawing again. So here, we're gonna look at this curve right here. So at 100 kilometers, we're right here. So the minimum temperature that could occur is essentially 500 degrees centigrade. If I go up, maybe 510. So we wanna add the minimum temperature would be around 500 degrees centigrade. And according to the geothermal gradients for both ocean and continental setting, the temperature is hotter than that. So we got plenty of temperature to produce magmas. So when you're looking at this hydrous flux melting or the wet prototype solidus here, is anything to the left is 100% rock. Over here to the right, we're gonna see partial melt. I put PM for partial melts are gonna occur on that side or to the right of that wet solidus. But again, this is only happening in subduction zones. So when we go over here, what type of process could water enter? So subduction, convergent margins. All right, so once you've gone through those questions, now you can answer these two questions. And so I'll let you do those questions there. Now for this next part on looking at magma and magma source depths, you're gonna draw to scale the depth. And for this one, I recommend if you have a compass, you can use a compass to draw circles. So label the four layers of Earth. So one thing as a heads up, this uppermost layer, and in fact, it's even too thick, this is gonna be our crust. And so just that line alone is thicker than the 30 kilometers that we have for the crust. And so according to this model, it's more like, cause remember that's 500, so that's like maybe 50 kilometers. So we'll just make that the crust. And then we see that the mantle goes from 30 to 2900. So we want to go down here to 2900, which is right in here. So we want to draw a circle with that diameter. And so with my compass, I'll just kind of label it out there. Then I can draw this circle of that diameter. So there would be our mantle. This would be the mantle in here. And then this would be the outer core. And they've already drawn in the inner core, right? So we have all the layers labeled. Now you can answer these questions down here. I'll let you answer those questions. On the next page, they're gonna ask us some questions about the origin of magma. And one important thing is that S waves do not travel through the entire mantle. They don't go through the core. So the outer core is liquid. So on the diagram, we want to draw a star at the depth where magma from volcanoes originate. And those usually originate at about a 100 kilometer depth. So if we add that in here on our, so basically we're gonna draw a star right in here. So there's my star, pretty shallow. So in other words, magmas are not coming from the core. They're coming up here from the uppermost mantle, either the asthenosphere or the mantle lithosphere. So now when we look at the questions here, so we've done this here. What layers melt to form magma? And so we want to say really the upper outer mantle. I want you to understand the upper mantle, that's where magmas come from. Overall, how much of the mantle is liquid? So remember, since S waves travel through the mantle, that must mean that the mantle must be pretty much solid. So really very little to none of the mantle is liquid. Maybe 1% in the asthenosphere, but that's very little. Now, according to your diagram, estimate how far molten metal from the outer core would have to travel to erupt as volcanoes. And so, and when we look here, we would see that it'd have to go around 3,000 kilometers, right? And also, we know that the outer core is basically an iron. It's mostly iron. But the lavas, these are silicate rocks that have silicon, magnesium, calcium, sodium, potassium, right? So they're very different compositions. Now you can sort of answer these two questions, right, for student 8. And then think about question 9 here. I'll let you do that one as well. The next part here deals with hotspots. And remember, hotspots are mantle plumes that emanate either from the core mantle boundary, and they travel a stationary path up through the mantle, and they basically burn a hole in the tectonic plates. But the plates are moving over these hotspots, and then they will carry volcanoes off the hotspots, and then new volcanoes will be formed. A good example of one of these hotspots is the Hawaiian Islands. And you can see that the ages are for Maui's 1.1, Molokai. So you can, we'll just look at the map for that. And so when we look at these questions for questions 1 and 2, we want to know where the hotspot is. Is it in Kauai, Oahu? It's going to be on the Big Island, because that's the one that the Big Island has. It has active volcanoes, whereas the other islands are all extinct. And which of these islands? Well, I just said only the Big Island has the active volcanoes, right? So looking at this picture, we can see their ages. You can see that the Big Island, the lavas are erupting now. They're active. But you can see as you go to Maui, Molokai, the ages of the lavas get older and older and older the farther you move away or to the northwest from the Hawaiian Islands. So it looks like about a million years ago, Maui was here and has since been carried to this position there. 4.7 million years ago, Kauai was over the hotspot and has since been moved to its position in 4.7 million years. Remember, the hotspot is here. It's traveling underneath through the mantle. It's just as the tectonic plate is moving. So we want to draw our arrow here. So it looks like the tectonic plate is moving in this direction toward the northwest, right? So that's the way the plate is moving, this Pacific plate. Now you can answer these two questions about two students debating where the hotspot is. For question 5, there is an underwater volcano, which is right in this region here. And that underwater volcano is called Lauihi. It's still below sea level. It's about 3,000 feet below sea level still. It's active. Lavas have been erupting out of it. And so we just put that circle there. So I just showed you where Lauihi is. And over time, Lauihi, as more eruptions happen, it'll eventually become an island. And Hawaii, because the Big Island of Hawaii is being moved or carried off the hotspot, and Lauihi will be the next Hawaiian island that will replace the Big Island of Hawaii here. So now we want to calculate a rate of motion for the Pacific Plate over the Hawaiian hotspot. And we want to do it from Kauai to Kilauea, right? So we're going from the Kilauea volcano, which is erupting now, this point here, and Kauai, which is over here. Note that the time is 4.7 million years. So for our rate is going to be some distance that we calculate divided by the 4.7 million years, right? That the distance between Kauai and the Big Island. Now, to do this, we got to measure the distance. So we'll do the same trick we did before. We got to calibrate our scale here. So on this one, I see that 150 kilometers is 3.5 centimeters. So we'll add that on here. So 150 kilometers is 3.5 centimeters. So if we divide both sides by 3.5, we're going to get 1 centimeter equals. So we'll do the math here. We'll take 150 divided by 3.5. So it's 43 kilometers. So every centimeter you measure on this map is 43 kilometers. So knowing that, we're going to measure the distance from Kauai to Kilauea. And I have 12 and a half centimeters. 12 and a half centimeters, right? So we'll have 12 and a half centimeters. 12.5 centimeters times the 43 kilometers per centimeter. And so the centimeters cancel out. We're going to get something in kilometers there, right? So we'll come over here. We'll go 43 3 times 12.5. And that's going to give us 538. So it's going to be 538 kilometers, right? So that's what we'll use. So now for our rate problem down here. So the rate is going to be the 538 kilometers over the 4.7 million years. So we'll go 538 divided by 4.7, and we get the 114 kilometers per million year. Remember, this is the same thing as saying 114 millimeters per year, right? Like I showed you before. And remember, there's 10 millimeters in a centimeter, so our answer is going to be 11.4 centimeters per year. So that's what you want to do for this problem there. So that, again, I'm just showing you how to calculate these rates. So that's our final answer for that problem there. And again, if we look at the rates of the Pacific Plate moving, you can see it's moving about 11 centimeters, 13.4, 10.8. So we're right in that ballpark here for the Pacific Plate. Now for this next problem here, just a heads up, this line represents a trench, and so we'll have to put the barbs on there, which is a reverse fault or a subduction zone. So this one does have a subduction zone, the trench, and we usually have to show those little barbs on it to indicate. And so remember, when we show this, these two plates are converging toward each other, right? They're moving toward each other at a convergent margin. And these little barbs point in the direction of subduction. So in other words, this plate is going underneath this plate. So you can think of the plate with the islands, this is the overriding plate. Whereas the plate that's being subducted, we call the subducting plate. All right, so knowing that, now you can answer these questions here. For question four, we have a couple of terms. There's ocean island volcanoes, and those are related to hotspots. And the key thing about these ocean island volcanoes, there's no trench and only one active volcanic island. Whereas island arc volcanoes, those are like Japan. Here we're going to have a trench, a subduction zone, right? And we'll have many active volcanic islands.